In the part 1 video, I built this wooden box around a 5-inch disc sander. This time we'll complete the whole fixture. Let's dive in. The table for my sander is going to be 22 inches square, and I'm putting it on a 4-inch riser. We need the riser for two reasons. The first is, when this box pivots down, we need a place for this bottom corner to go. And also, to create discs with precision, I want to make a slider that holds the disc. And there'll be a lock nut that holds the slider in place that goes in this area. So we need access to reach the lock nut. So the next step is, I'll join these parts together with drywall screws. So the base is assembled, and I've jigged up the box approximately where it goes. I'm going to put another piece of 3/4-inch plywood on top of the table, and I'm going to cut a strip 4 3/4 inches wide out of the center. This will be the slider. And the way this works is, when I'm creating a disc, the disc will fasten to this slider. And then I can move the slider up until the edge of the disc touches the sanding disc, rotate the disc, move the slider, rotate the disc, move the slider, and this way I can sneak up on the precise diameter I'm trying to achieve. And one more thing I'm going to do is to cut a 45 degree angle on the leading edge of this top surface of the table. That will allow me to position the hinges where they work best. Now I can assemble the top layer of the tabletop. So that's how everything fits together, and you can see the slide works great. I've drilled a pilot hole in the slide for the locking screw, and I'm going to drill through that hole into the base to make the hole for that locking screw. So I'm going to put a threaded insert in the slide itself, and then I'll cut a slot in the bottom to allow the full movement of this slide. So I've drilled a through hole, and now I'm going to cut a notch that comes right up to meet that hole. So the notch is a done deal. I want to put a threaded insert in this slide, so I'm using a product called the T-nut. These come in many different sizes. This particular one is 1/4-20. And I want this to fit flush, so I'm going to make a little recess around this pilot hole. And I'll use a 3/4-inch spade drill to do that. Okay, that looks like just the right depth. Now I need to drill a larger hole for the body of this. So now I'll hammer this to fasten it into place. So that's all it takes. The T-nut is fitting nice and flush, and these threads will enable us to lock this slide into place. It's time to fit the hinges into place now. So this is where they go. The screws for this hinge will go up into this angled surface, and I want to set it up so that the point on this edge is centered on the hinge pin. So to do that, I need to remove a little material. The barrel of the hinge is about 1/4-inch wide, so I'm going to file away about 1/8 inch of material right on this peaked edge. I'll test fit this now, and that looks just about perfect. So I'll file away the notch on this side as well. I just discovered that I need to remove a little material off this face as well, so I'll do that by sanding. That should do it, and I'll do the same thing on the other side. So to locate the hinges, I'm going to hold it in place so the center of the hinge pin is right on this edge. I'll put this carefully into place and then mark the holes with a pencil. I'll do that on both sides. So now I'll drill pilot holes for the screws. And now I can screw the hinge plates into place. So now we can mount the box to the hinges. The box needs to be notched for the hinges too, so I'll take the top and the front off the box, and I marked an 1/8 inch place where I need to put the chamfer. And I'll file the other side. So now I can put the box into place, and we'll find the locations needed for the screws for the hinges. I'll make sure everything is centered nicely. Then I'll make a mark with a pencil through the holes in the hinges. Now I'll drill a pilot hole for the screws. And now I can put the screws into place. Okay, so here's the moment of truth. Let's see how all this works. And ladies and gentlemen, look at that. It pivots perfectly down to 45 degrees, just like I wanted. And the reason I was so careful to get the center of the pin aligned with the edge of the boards is so that we don't get a big gap here when this moves through its arc. So it's looking great so far, and the last step is going to be to notch out the covers that fit over these hinges. Looking at the underside of this, I'm very happy with how smoothly everything moves, but I found one small point of interference. As this gets down close to 45 degrees, the edge of the disc starts to touch this piece of plywood, so I need to put a notch in here to clear the disc. So I've opened up a pocket at the base of the disc, and I've made that pocket large enough so it's easy to pull discs off and replace them without having to remove the sander from the box. That'll be so convenient. And then we can tip the disc upright, move the slide forward, and we're ready to go. I want to have the ability to quickly change the angle of the disc and lock it securely. I may want a 15 degree angle, I may want 30, I may want 45, but whatever angle I choose, I want to be able to lock it securely and then release it and quickly bring it back up to vertical. So that's the next thing we'll take a look at. So here's the plan for the angle lock. I've cut a piece of wood that will be a cap for the end of the box, so there'll be screws that hold this to the box. And then as the box and the disc rotate back, this will swing up, and I'll have a knob here, and it'll be easy to lock it at whatever angle I want. So I've installed the end cap on the box, and I've drilled a hole through this board and put a T-nut on the back side, and now there's a threaded stud sticking out from the T-nut. And there's one more thing I've done that's important. I put a screw in here that sticks out about 1/4 inch, and that acts as a fulcrum so the clamping washer has something to work against. So here's how all the parts fit together. Let's put this in place. We'll put the clamping washer in place, put the knob on the threaded stud and tighten it. And this has enough clamping pressure that it holds the box very, very stationary. Let's move this up a little higher. And again, we can clamp it there and it holds it very well. Let's go all the way up vertical and clamp it there. So this knob gives us excellent clamping pressure and it's easy to change the angle. I made a sheet metal guard that covers the edge of the disc, and that'll provide some safety as I reach for the switch. So I'm ready to sand the edge of the first disc. I'm going to make a disc that's exactly 10 inches in diameter, so I've cut a blank slightly oversized. The first step is I want to pull this slide back a little bit to create a gap between the slide and the disc. Then I'll put the wooden disc into place, and I want the point of contact of the edge to be about halfway between the center of the sanding disc and the edge. And in that position, I'll put a drywall screw into place to act as a pivot. So when the sanding disc is spinning, all I need to do is to rotate the wooden disc against the sanding disc, and then progressively I'll tap this slide in farther and farther until I have precisely a 10-inch disc. So the first thing is I'll put my safety gear on. Thank you. So there we are at 10 inches, right on the money. So as you can see, this leaves a perfectly round edge that's very, very smooth. So let's send a disc with a 45 degree edge angle now. The first step is to rotate the disc back to 45 degrees. So I'll loosen the lock for the box, move it back to 45 degrees, lock it into place. Then I'll move the disc up, put a drywall screw in the center to lock it in place. Now I'll put my safety gear on and start sanding the edge. So we'll pull that off and take a look. And I would say that's done a fantastic job. So let's try a really big disc now. So once again, the sander has done a fantastic job. I know this disc is perfectly round and it has a very smooth edge. This is Ron in the future, talking to you in the present, showing the cooling holes I made in the past to keep the motor from overheating. This has been a fun project for me, and it works even better than I hoped. You'll be seeing me put the tool to use very soon, and the precision it delivers will be very helpful. If you enjoy my videos, please like, subscribe, and click the bell to be notified when I post a new project. If you like, you can support these videos through Patreon. Just click the link at the end of the video. I'll see you next time.